is acceptable as far as the sacrifice. And we've been talking about the sacrifices. We've been discussing the burnt offering. And we've hit on this a little bit before, but I want to just share a few things. Partially what I'm going to do is just share some things along this line that the Lord put on my heart, and then I'm going to share some things that I've written down. Probably just read some of it. 1 Peter chapter 1, and let's read verse 18 and 19. Remember, we're talking about what is acceptable. For as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things, like silver and gold, from your vain manner of life received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb, without blemish and without spot. So let's just consider that for a moment. I've made reference to Peter, that he was he was a man who was all out for God as much as he knew how. His heart was for the Lord. And I think that most of us here are that way, or at least feel that we are that way, that we're as much for the Lord as we can give and go. And Peter got to the end of 3.5 years of ministry with Jesus. In other words, he walked with Jesus, he talked with Jesus. Now, I mean, we walk with Jesus and we talk with Jesus, but Peter, like, had him right there. I mean, that had to be a blessing, you know. So here Peter has got Jesus right there every morning and every night and all day long, and he can ask him any question he wants. And he gets to the end of 3.5 years, and he's the most committed. He's the one that's ready to walk on the water. He's the one that said, I will die for you. He's the one that in his mind, and this is what you have to understand, and you'll never understand his letters until you understand what was going on in his mind when he was the top ace, number one disciple. He was the cream of the crop. I mean, you know, there was, when it talks about the three being separated, like on the Mount of Transfiguration or something like that, you know, Peter, James, and John. Well, if you'll notice the order, it's Peter, James, and John. And Jesus even uses that order. So Peter is like, he's the man. He's going to be the leader. He's going to be the one that goes further than anybody else. But when it gets to the end of 3.5 years, when it gets to the end of the discipleship phase, where you're no longer going to be taught, now you're going to be an apostle at the end of this. He's standing there. Jesus is taken, and he runs and hides, and then he goes and gets around the fire, and he's questioned, how committed are you? I mean, are you a follower of Jesus? No, I don't know him, and denied him. He got to see 3 times in a very short span how absolutely corruptible he was. And I've shared this in past, that this guy uses the phrase corruptible and incorruptible all the time. 1 Peter 1:23, just a few verses down from here. Being born again is what he says, not of corruptible seed. That's, the new birth is not us again, but of incorruptible. That's Christ. Christ is the new life. There is no Christian life. The Christian life is Christ living in the Christian. And so when Peter writes, he writes always from this place of, I'm corruptible, you're corruptible, everything's corruptible. The only thing that will not fail is Jesus. And so for Peter to understand that the new birth is an incorruptible seed, which is Christ, not just a commitment to the teachings of Jesus, because he had been committed to the teachings of Jesus for 3.5 years. He had been a follower of Jesus to the max. He had been one who had witnessed miracles. He had seen the power of God. He had experienced it in his own life. His mother had a fever. Jesus healed her over and over, saw major things. The dead raised up. But he saw that seeing all of that and all of the experiences of God doing stuff around you didn't make you incorruptible. Only he was incorruptible, and that seed had to be the new birth in us, or we all would fail. Can I get an amen from somebody? I know that I'll get an amen from Peter, because he knows. He knows. So he's all, just go through the first epistle. It's all the way through the other one, too. But this thing, this contrast of corruptible and incorruptible. And I thought how very incredible these words are that he's writing now. He's gotten through his ordeal because he realized he is corruptible, and that the new birth, not following Jesus, not because he followed for 3.5 years, not following Jesus, not committing yourself to Jesus, but the new birth being another life living not just in you, but living as you, was his only hope. The only hope of what? Not turning around and denying the Lord again. Not turning around and self-protecting. Not lying or doing whatever he's got to do to get out of the situation so that he doesn't look bad. Do you understand what I'm saying? I mean, this was devastating to Peter to fail the Lord in this way, but it was glorious because in one fell swoop, it was branded upon his consciousness. I am corruptible. And not only did that happen in him, but he was the best of the best of the three, of the 12, of the 70, of the multi. He was the best of the best of the best. And he came away with, you are corruptible too. It better be Jesus, not you. Paul said, not I, but Christ liveth in me. Okay? So when he writes, you may hear... you may hear religious terminology and apply it to sermons and big gatherings in a building where you hear religious teaching. Peter wasn't coming from that angle at all. Peter's coming from one angle, and that is, I know I'm not it, and I know Jesus is. And I'm now an apostle to pretty much tell you people that you're corruptible. And that he's not, and it must be Christ in you. So, with that in mind, when you read this, not the religious view, but you read this, listen to these words again. For as much as you know that you were redeemed, not with, what is the term? Corruptible things. Not with corruptible things, now get this, like silver and gold. You see, he was the best of the best. He was not wood, hay, and stubble. He was silver and gold. Am I right or wrong? He was the most committed. He was the most after. He was silver and gold. And he said, not like corruptible things like silver and gold. See, we would say not like corruptible things like wood, hay, and stubble. That stuff that, you know, that's flaky, but redeemed with, you know, and we might not even fully recognize that everything, not just the bad, flaky wood things, but everything is corruptible. And the only thing that will last, will continue is Christ. And the only thing that will not fail, the only thing that will stay the same, the only thing that does not suffer loss is Christ. Can I get amen? Christ in you is the hope. Okay? So he doesn't go where most of us would go. He doesn't go to the poor and the beat up and the outcast. He goes to the very best, the most committed, and says, hey, silver, gold. You're just as corruptible as anybody else. You are just as bad as that is. It's all going to pass away except for Christ and Christ's life within us. And us, and not just pass away, not just longevity, but in terms of corruptibility whereby you will fail. No matter how much you give yourself to the Lord, no matter how much you read the Bible, no matter how much you fail or how much you try, you will fail because you are corruptible. God's hope is not in you. Now, I've shared this before, but I mean, I remember when I was in Bible school, and I remember thinking, Jesus came down here, ministered for only 3.5 years, called people like Judas and Peter and James and John, the sons of thunder, and, you know, all these guys that denied him, that betrayed him, that stealing money, that were trying to be the greatest. I mean, all of these guys, and he only teaches them for 3.5 years and then goes away, and the whole hope for the whole world is on these 12, these 11. And I remember thinking, are you crazy, Jesus? These guys, you know, they're going to mess it. They can't do it. And I always wondered, how could God put trust and flaky guys like that? And then I realized his trust was never in them. His trust was in his plan, and his plan was that Christ would be formed in every one of them. That's pretty good. That's reason for God to trust. That's reason for the Father to trust. It's going to work out as long as it's my son. That's what the Father's thinking. You see that? So Peter is there to stand on the front line, to speak to the most committed, to speak to those who would go the furthest, to speak to those who would die for the Lord, to speak to those and to say, all of your silver is corruptible. All of your glittery gold, the best of you are corruptible. But he says, but you were not redeemed with corruptible things like that, but rather with the precious blood of Christ. Now, that's where we always leave off, because we don't comprehend the blood. We believe that Jesus' blood had like little jewels and stuff and glittery things that floated around, and just the amoebas of it or whatever, you know, or just the plasma was just like, you know, angelic. All of it had little halos and stuff, you know. We think that there was something magical. But here's the key. But with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb. Because the blood that is precious to God is not just Jesus' blood, and if you'll check it every time, it's shed blood. And if you look in Hebrews, turn to Hebrews chapter 9. We'll see it again here. We've looked at this before. Hebrews 9, verse 14. How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? Notice, how much more shall the blood of Jesus, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself? Jesus gave himself through the Spirit and nature, the eternal Spirit that is God. Another way of describing this eternal Spirit we call God is, it is self-giving. Another way is, it is a lamb. Another way is, it pours itself out, who offered himself for others. You see, the blood is no value in the veins of Jesus. It is shed blood, which represents poured out life. Anybody getting this? Not just magic blood. Poured out blood representing a poured out, because the life is in the blood. Am I right or wrong? The life is in the blood. Therefore, when it's poured out, the shed blood is poured out life for others who don't deserve it. Am I right or wrong? Okay, that's why Hebrews 9, verse 14 is particularly emphasizing that Jesus he wasn't just a good man who gave himself. He didn't give himself thinking it was acceptable simply to do that. He gave himself through the eternal spirit, the eternal self-giving spirit that pours itself out for others and the ungodly and the undeserving. That's the eternal spirit. That's God. For God so loved, he gave himself, his son, you see. So, we're talking about, what is acceptable. Now, you've noticed in both of the scriptures, it talks about he shed his blood, he gave himself, and he was without spot or blemish. Now, this is significant for a lot of reasons, but I'm only going to hit one reason right now. And that is the only acceptable sacrifice has to be without spot or blemish. That's not you. The only acceptable sacrifice has to be one without spot or blemish. The eternal spirit that gives himself is the one who is without spot or blemish. Did that just go right over your head? The only spirit that is eternal is one who is without spot or blemish. Jesus never sinned. We always say that. Folks, Jesus not only never sinned. Now, are you ready for this? Jesus not only didn't sin, Jesus didn't walk around with bad attitudes or bad motivations or selfish motivations. Now, every Christian is supposed to be filled with the eternal spirit. Can I get an amen? So what do we conclude here? 1 + 1 is that we may not be sinning, but if we are offering our good, our gold and our silver, it's still corruptible and it's still not the acceptable sacrifice. Christ in you is the one who is supposed to be given unto the Father, and you're supposed to be an earthen vessel. You're supposed to be the body of the self-giving one. Does that make sense? The body. We're the body of Christ. You could say we're the body of Christ. Well, that means nothing other than, really, here's what it means. We're the body of Christ. That means that we're the only right believers, and thank God that we go to church. We are the church. The Bible never told you to go to church. So stop it. I don't want to see anybody here on Sunday ever again. That's not the deal. I'm telling you not to go to church. I'm telling you to be the church. I'm telling you to gather as the church. But the church, the best definition I can find is when Paul said, we are the church, the body of Christ. Okay. That's a definition of church. We are the church, the vehicle of the life of Christ. The vehicle of his expression. That's the true purpose, not to just gather and sing songs and hear a sermon and all that kind of stuff. That's not the purpose. If we gather to hear the word and to grow more in the image of Christ and have him formed in us, then we're going to church for the right reason, for the right motivations. But in truth, we're not going to church. We're being the church, and we're seeking to be the church and to live as that. Or we're fulfilling religious duties by making sure that at least once a week, possibly Sunday morning, we. And then in church services, we're encouraged to offer up an unacceptable sacrifice, one that is with spot and blemish. Am I right or wrong? Give, give, give your money, give yourself, give this, give that. No, you give through the eternal Spirit. Christ is your life. Christ is in you. Christ gives. Christ pours out. Christ notices a need and he'll go just give, because that's just how he lives and how he works and how he functions, and it's not all planned out and whatever and necessarily. I mean, there's spontaneity to his life and there's reality of it's Jesus. Not just, I'm doing my religious duty as a Christian and this is what Christians do. You know, we're missing, the only thing we're missing out of that is Jesus. I mean, he's still there, but he's not here. He's like on a throne far away. He's not living in us. We're not being the temple. But we're acknowledging that he's around, you know, that he's at least on a throne, and then he shows up every once in a while in a church service that's pretty hot. Woo! Jesus, just, you know, I remember I was in a conference once, thousands of people, and a brother stood up and said, Jesus just walked in the door. I said, I know, he came when I brought him. Yeah, I mean, I'm joking, but the point is, he's pointing over there in an area where there's nobody and saying, I see Jesus. He just walked in the door. And I'm thinking, nowhere in the New Testament is Jesus supposed to be walking in the door of a church service. He's supposed to be living in the church. I mean, you know, and I didn't go, well, you backslidden, half-hearted heretic, get out. I didn't do that. I don't get into the rebuking side. I just want us to line up with the Word of God. That's all. And there's so much cultural religion to Christianity that we are not, it's not even clear anymore, you know? So, but the only way it's ever going to get clear is for us to get into the Scriptures, and that includes you challenging the things that I teach you in this Bible school or any of the other teachers. Don't just sit and listen to everybody and say, oh, well, praise God, they're in the know. They've been in the ministry all this many years. Most Christians are following a set of teachings, whether it's the faith teaching or the healing movement or the this or that. They're following the set of teachings of some guy that came before, and he lined out a certain teachings, and you lean in that direction. But you don't know the Scriptures from chapter to chapter to book, and this is what I believe. Most Christians don't. We need to know Jesus, and we need to know the Scriptures. And that's one of the reasons for having a Bible school. I mean, amen? And one of the reasons, you know, so I, you know, you notice that most of the time I don't just stand up here and, you know, just, I mean, I try to go to the Scriptures. But you still shouldn't just take anything I say or Jim or anybody else around here says. You should go to the Word and cry out to God and ask the Holy Spirit to open the book that you may see Jesus. And do it all the time and every time. Because, I mean, I'll tell you, I mean, the Spirit of God, I think it was this year. This year's gone by quick. But the Lord gave me about a month of just pouring the Word out, opening, I mean, just anywhere I flipped, and he'd just show me something. And every time, it was so above and beyond and bigger and wider and deeper and further and more, the more real meaning fitting with all the context and everything, than anything I'd ever seen in all those Scriptures. And he took me to almost 300 separate Scriptures. At the end of it, my conclusion was, my God, I don't even know the Word of God. You know? And it's been, I mean, we're creeping up on 40 years. Getting real close to 40 years walking with the Lord. And I barely know the Scriptures from Him. You know, anybody can just quote Scripture. The Pharisees could quote Scripture. The devil could quote Scriptures. The devil quoted Scriptures to Jesus. Am I right or wrong? You know, I don't think he carried around a little Bible with him. He probably memorized it. Do you know the nowhere does it say to memorize the scriptures? It says search the scriptures and let the Spirit reveal Christ in them. Now I figure if you stay in the scriptures like you ought to, you may actually memorize some things. Can I get an amen? But you won't be trying to memorize it. You understand? You'll just remember it. You know? Oh, I remember that scripture. Or how about this? Jesus said, He, the Spirit of truth, when He shall come, He shall bring to your remembrance all the things that I've said. Well, what did He say? What's the part in red? In other words, the scriptures. And He'll bring to your remembrance. So if it was only just memorize the scriptures, we wouldn't need the Holy Spirit. Right? Well, I don't need the Holy Spirit. I'm a Pharisee. I got it all memorized. I can tell you anything you want to know anywhere. Okay, do you see Jesus in any of that? No, but, you know, I ran into a guy the other night, scared me to death, man. He was a headhunter. He was a Christian. Met him at Whataburger. And, oh, man, he was on the warpath against sin and against Christians and anybody that, you know, that sinned or anything. You know, which I'm thinking, what? Now, we know Jesus, the only one, hadn't sinned. And you? What was your name? You know, like the devil says, Jesus I know and Kenneth I know. You know, I'm telling you, the guy sins just like anybody else. You know, whether it's selfish motivations that cause you to, if it's self that causes you to steal something, or self that causes you to stand in front of people and act self-righteous. Self-righteousness is same as out of self, just like wanting, coveting something and stealing it for self. It's all self. And you know what? It's all corruptible. And I always get afraid when I see people like that, because God will eventually bring them down, and when they do, they're going to crash really, really hard. I mean, it's not like, You know, and then it's hard to pick up the pieces when you think you're supposed to be perfect. Unless you just realize from the start, the only acceptable sacrifice is Christ, and the only acceptable spirit that will offer the right thing is the eternal spirit, Christ giving Himself through His body, giving Himself in His temple, giving Himself in an earthen vessel, giving Himself through a branch as He is the life of the vine. Because a vine really doesn't have a trunk. If you see a vine, all it is branches. Right? See, we want to see a big, glorious trunk. There's Jesus. And then we see all these flaky branches and go, oh, there's us. Folks, He's the vine, we're the branches, and the vine life is all that is pumping through all those individual branches. There's no special branch that represents, or trunk that represents Jesus. There's just His life in us that represents Jesus. Amen? Or am I wrong about vines? I mean, for the most part, they're just going everywhere, you know? All right, so God made it from the very beginning. All offerings, if they were going to be acceptable, had to be without spot or blemish. And as I've said before, this is to make sure that we understand that God wants His Son, and no offerings and sacrifices by us without Him being the life and motivation of it are acceptable. Still glad you came to this Bible school? And all were offered on one specific altar. God said you can't just make an altar anywhere. You have to offer on the main altar, and the main altar is the cross. Your death happened at the cross. After you're dead, Jesus raises, but His self-giving nature still lives. Do you understand that? We died with Christ, but when He rose from the dead, the one who rose from the dead was the eternal spirit. the self-giving one. You say, no, I'll be self-giving until the resurrection, and then I'll be selfish. Then I'll get, you know, mansions and streets of gold and gates of pearl and, you know, crowns and all this stuff. But right now, I'm going to do without. God's spirit, his nature, is one of self-giving all the time. Check it out. Look in the book of Revelation. What's he like? A lamb on the throne as though he had been slain. That's the resurrected one. The resurrected, look at the picture it gives you in the book of Revelation. It doesn't show, you know, one sitting there going, yes! I, you know, like Conan the Barbarian or something. You know, big old arms and... I have defeated the devil and all enemies. Now you will be conquerors with me. No, you're more than conquerors. You are not a conqueror. You are more than a conqueror. And what it says, it describes more than a conqueror as this. You face nakedness and peril and persecution and all of this stuff. But in all of those things, you are more than folks. A conqueror would not face nakedness and peril. And am I right? The general understanding of a conqueror would not go, I conquered all this. I don't go through this. But the scripture says, I am persuaded that nothing shall separate me from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. Whether life or death or principalities or powers or things present or things to come, nakedness or peril or, you know, all of these lost persecution and, you know, in all these things, in them, we're more than conquerors through him. And then it goes on to say that we are as sheep before the slaughter, for the slaughter. That's what it says. What does that mean? It means that only the lamb, listen to this. If you lay down your life without Jesus, there is not going to be any resurrection. I don't care how much it looks like Jesus. It's you. Unacceptable. Only in his death or his self-giving is there life out of death. So it must be Christ in us. Right? John said it this way, by this perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us, and we've all got John 3:16 down. He laid down his life for us. And we ought to lay down our lives, not for God, but for the brethren. You see? Oh, I'll lay down my life for God, but I ain't pitching in, or I'm not going to help so-and-so. Brother so-and-so. You know? Anyway. So, there is this, let's go back to, well, right, since we're in Hebrews, let's look in Hebrews 13, in verse 15. By him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God, continually, that is, the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. By him, therefore, how many people have read this scripture and left Jesus out of this? You left by him out of this, and all you've ever understood is, therefore let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually. Anybody ever thought that? We're just supposed to walk around and praise God, but it doesn't say that. It says, by him let us. Why? Because there's only one acceptable sacrifice, and it's talking about sacrifices, and God hadn't changed his economy to allow any old thing to be thrown up on the altar and find acceptance. It's still always got to be by the eternal spirit, by him. Whatever you do, if you, we'll see this in a minute in relationship to worship, but that it all be by Christ. In fact, we were in Peter, go ahead there, and there's the scripture that talks about it. 1 Peter 2. Yeah, 1 Peter 2:5. Ye also, as living stones, are built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. Now, the way we read that is we're to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God. But what did we do? When we say it like that, we leave out Jesus. It says, by Jesus Christ. How can we as Christians leave Jesus out of so much when he's the heart, the soul, the mind, the spirit of what Christianity is, of what the body of Christ is? How can we leave Jesus out? You see, Peter knew that because of the corruptible thing. He found out that him and his height of commitment still would fail God. So he knew, I can never leave Jesus out. Everything must be by Christ, or it's going to corrupt, because it'll be me. Does anybody really see the incredibleness of Peter's revelation? I mean, how hard was that for Peter to go through that and then to see Jesus hanging on the cross, and John's up there at front, but Peter's back hiding, never did come near the cross, never did, you know, just stayed back, was afraid. I mean, Jesus' words to him were, fear not. Anybody ever had trouble with fear? You know, I think it was some Christian show or something I saw the other day, and the guy said, Jesus said, fear not, 365 times in the Bible. Or it says, fear not, 365 times in the New Testament. Okay, well, that's one for every day of the year, right? But let's get out of time and space and act as eternal beings. How about Jesus just walk up once and say, fear not, and we go, that's your word, I'm with you, you're my head, you're my Lord, you're my life, you know, I'm with you, you don't ever have to say it to me again. But what happens is, he says, fear not, so we get over it until the next day. And then we go, when are you going to show up? I mean, it's only day two. So he shows up, fear not, oh, okay, whew, you know, so the day three, oh. I mean, anybody following me here? I mean, does this even make sense? You know, how about just receive him, receive his heart, receive his word, and say, just say it to me once, I'm with you. You know, you don't have to show up every day and deal with my fears. You know why? Because he didn't just tell you to stop fearing. He became your life. And as such, Jesus doesn't walk around. Do you think Jesus walked around the earth for 3.5 years going, you know? I mean, Ben and Cassie have a dog named Waylon, and he's real friendly and real sweet. But if he doesn't know you, you know, he'll come over to smell and whatever and smell your hand. But if you just move a little bit like that, he goes, oh, and runs off, you know? It's like, oh, you know? Can you see Jesus walking around going, well, you know, I'm going to talk about the Sermon on the Mount. Is that okay with everybody? You know, and you know, I'm going to heal you. Is this going to be good or bad? If I heal you, will you, you know, backslide or become, you know, self-focused or I don't know. You know, I don't know. Okay, we are assured Jesus didn't walk around in his body and do that, right? Do you think he's walking around in his body today doing that? You see what I mean? In other words, telling Adam not to fear is pretty, you better have 365 days, and you better have 365 for each day. Don't fear, don't fear, don't fear. Don't fear, don't fear, don't fear. No, don't fear that. Oh, you know, don't fear the reaper. You know, don't. Sorry. You know, all this stuff. You know, he can tell us not to fear because in his resurrection, we became one with him. We became his body, and now his life will live through us. And even if they crucify him, he's not hanging up on the cross going, this turned bad. You know, this really didn't work out. I'm sort of afraid in that sense, you know. Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Apparently, he knew what he was doing. I'm dying for the ones who don't know what they're doing. He knows what he's doing. So, I mentioned that we would look in Genesis. Look over in Genesis 22. I want to talk about Abraham offering Isaac. Now, you know, Abraham offering Isaac is a picture of the father giving his only son. You know that, right? It's not just a story about a man and his boy. A story of a man and his dog, you know, or a man and his boy. No, all of this is a picture of Christ. Jesus said, search the scripture, it all testifies of me. Quit looking for, you know, encouraging scriptures and start looking for me. So, Genesis 22, you'll spot it right away if you just think of the father giving his son. And part of the reason why this story is in here is we all know that Jesus gave himself. I don't know that we all really know what the father went through. You know, the father gave his son. You know what? It's like with my kids or something like that. If I, you know, if they had the choice between them dying or me dying, I would choose I will die. You understand? It would be harder for me to let them die than for me to just die. It was harder for the father to give his son than for him just to come and die. It was harder for the father to see the cruel treatment and the mocking and the beating and all the stuff that happened to his son. See, we look at Jesus as a religious figure dying for our sins. He was somebody's son. You know, I remember one time a family came to me and they wanted counseling because their son had died. And they just didn't understand why God would do this and why this and that and that. And they needed answers and they were brokenhearted and their life was turned upside down. And I just said, God understands. And they said, how can God understand? God allowed this. God did this to me. God did this to my child, took my son. I said, God lost a son once. But we never think of that. We never think of what he must have gone through when Jesus was being beaten, when Jesus wasn't given a fair trial. You know what I'm saying? You know, and just at the random hands of man who are going to do what they're going to do, slap him and beat him and shove a spear in his side and all that kind of stuff. This story helps us to understand when it says, for God so loved the world that he gave his son, what that means, that the father gave his son. Genesis 22 and verse 1, and it came to pass after these things that God did test Abraham and said unto him, Abraham, and he said, behold, here am I. And he said, take now thy son. Listen to these words. He's speaking to this father. Take now thy son, thine only son, Isaac, whom thou lovest. Does that sound familiar? Your son, your only begotten son, the son whom you love. And get thee into the land of Moriah and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains which I will tell thee of. And Abraham rose up early in the morning and saddled his ass and took two of his young men with him and Isaac his son and cut the wood for the burnt offering and rose up and went into the place of which God had told him. Then on the third day Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place afar off. And Abraham said unto his young men, abide ye here with the ass, and I and the lad will go yonder and worship. Do you think he had a worship service up there? I mean, what we call a worship service. You know, he got up there and went, hallelujah. And I'm not trying to make fun. I love worship. So please don't read that. But I mean, come on, picture Abraham going, oh, glory, oh, the glory. You know, I want to show you what true worship is. Okay, please forgive me if I'm not trying to be sacrilegious or whatever. I'm just me, okay? which is pretty sacrilegious. All right. And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it upon Isaac, his son, and he took the fire in his hand and a knife, and they went both of them together. And Isaac spoke unto Abraham, his father, and said, My father. And he said, Here am I, my son. And he said, Behold the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering? And Abraham said, My son, God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering. So they went both of them together now. God provides himself as a lamb. Amen. He doesn't just want Isaac. He doesn't just want, because Isaac has got spot and blemish. So, Abraham's description of this action of offering the son to the father. Did you hear what I said? His description of this action of him offering the son to the father, he called it worship. Wow. What a definition. You know, how many people worship during the week, you know, in all the churches and all, how many people offer the son to the father on a regular basis and call that worship? You know? I mean, think about it. There's a lot of worship services going on. And again, I'm not putting that down, but you know, let's just consider this for a minute. I mean, just be open for a second as I say this. You know, there is not one worship service mentioned in the New Testament. There is a place where at the end of of communion, they sang a hymn and went out. That's what it says. So if you've gone to worship choruses, you need to get back to hymns. I'm just kidding. I'm kidding, but I'm trying to make a point. If you're going to be scriptural, see, it's not about being scriptural. It's about Christ who fulfills the scripture living through us. Being scriptural is what, I'm sorry, I'll say it, that's what a Pharisee does. Well, that's not scriptural. Well, that's what they said to Jesus. That's not scriptural. It's not lawful for you to do this. It's not scriptural. You know, the devil says, well, cast yourself down from the thing because the scriptures say, and if you don't do it, you're not scriptural. Jesus didn't run around going, I've got to fulfill every scripture. He was the fulfillment of every scripture. You know, it's like giving me chocolate and saying, and this chocolate says, oh, I've got to fulfill the office of chocolate. You are chocolate. You don't have to do something to fulfill being chocolate. You are what it is. Well, Jesus was what fulfilled the whole thing. Okay? So, you know, the Bible says to us that we are to worship, Jesus said this, we're to worship in spirit and in truth. Amen. And where that scripture is located is at the woman at the well, and they were making a point that Jesus was standing there in Samaria, the place of Jacob's well, and this woman at the well came, and she was a Samaritan, and she said, now the Jews say, because she's a Samaritan, and she knows Jesus is a Jew, now the Jews say that you can only worship in Jerusalem, but Jacob, our father, and the father of all those Jews worshiping there, worshiped here in this mount. And Jesus says, look, verily, verily, I say unto you, the time is coming and now is when all those who worship will worship in spirit and in truth. In other words, it does not matter the location. What matters is that you offer up the Son to the Father. You can do it in Jacob's mountain. You can do it in Jerusalem. You can do it in Denton. Wow. Right here, just like Abraham, you can give the Father the son that he's asking for. Except the Father really wasn't asking for Isaac. Many of you are holding on to your little Isaacs, especially Patty. The They're not here, thank God. But I mean, you know, we all have our little eyes. Oh, you know, I don't want the Lord to, you know, every time the Lord speaks, you know, he's going to, you know. I mean, remember he says, Abraham, and he said, here am I, Lord. We're afraid he's going to get our Isaac. So he says, you know, calls your name and you go, you say, maybe if I act like I'm not here, he won't ask for it. I'm going to hold it. I'm going to keep it. He doesn't want that. He wants Jesus. He doesn't want the thing that you don't want to give him. He doesn't. He doesn't want, you know, I really want that because you want it. Can you imagine how petty God the Father would be if, you know, I want it. I mean, I remember my girls when they were little, you know, we'd buy one toy, you know, we learned to buy three of the same thing to give it to them so they wouldn't fight over stuff. But you buy one thing, and I want it, I want it, I know I want it, I want it. I want it, I want it. Ah! Why are y'all looking over there at Cassie? Y'all did the same thing when you're selfish little brats. So God is sitting there going, oh, if you really want it, I want it. You think that's what God's like? I mean, this is Almighty God. What do you got there? You know, I mean, come on, how petty is this guy? You know, don't turn away. Let me see. What is that? I think I want that. You know, we think he's after everything that we really want. No, he's not. He's after your heart to give him the son. And I guarantee Abraham knew that. See, Abraham knew that because he went to worship. Do you understand what I mean? He knew that worship was to give the Father the Son. So he wasn't worried. He said, okay, you want this? You want Isaac? Okay, here he is. You know, I've got the fire, I've got the wood and everything. We're ready. Lays him on the altar, draws back the knife and everything. I'm ready. God said, hold it. That's not really the son that I want. That's not really the lamb that I want. God will provide himself a lamb for the burnt offering, not a sin offering. This was free thing from Abraham's heart, not because he sinned. But the sweet savor offerings are only sweet to God when they're given willingly, and they are Christ. That's you know, oh, I'm going to give God a sweet savor offering. I'm going to give him my Xbox. No. I didn't know we had one here, but thank you, Jesus. Again, it's not your special things that he's after. What was special to Mary was her alabaster box of ointment that she was saving for the day she gets married, or or some incredibly special occasion. And even the death of the brother that she loved, Lazarus, wasn't special enough. But when Jesus came, she knelt at his feet. She looked in his face. She heard his word. She was transformed, and she got this thing that was so important to her before, and broke it and poured it on his feet and poured it out. And it wasn't like that sound you heard a few minutes ago. You know, Mary wasn't going, why? No, why do you ask for this? You see what I'm saying? In other words, you know, the devil can act like, you know, can sound like God. Did you know that? The devil can come to you and say, this is God. You go, oh, really? Okay. You know, what do you want? Well, let's see. What do you got? Well, I got this. Okay, I'll take it in that order. You know. Yeah, the devil pawns himself off as God. You'll never know unless you know how God really is, and I'll tell you how he is. God wants his son. Amen. He's not trying to torment you. He's not trying to rob you. I mean, the scriptures do say, God came to rob, steal, destroy. No, that's not God. By the way, that's not the devil either. Those scriptures have no reference to the devil, but it's gone out that way, and so that's the way everybody believes it. Find out what the scriptures say, not what everybody else says the scriptures say. That is not a reference to the devil. It's a reference to the Pharisees. You know? Check it out. And that's what you're supposed to do in this place. You're supposed to check it out. All right, so so to offer God worship means that God counts as worship what is us allowing Christ to give himself, whether it's to one another, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren, or it's to the Father, so that our worship, in other words, we can really be worshiping, but it just be us. And let me just clarify before I get into that. Maybe I'll try to close with this. Mary said, "My soul doth magnify the Lord, and my spirit exalts in God my Savior." I believe that our souls have a place in worship. Okay? Christ lives in our spirit, and as some would say, is now the spirit life. He is the life. He is the life in the spirit. He is the life in our spirit. So that's Christ. But in our soul, there is a place for you to lift up your soul. Now, I know people who say, "Oh, I don't want any soulish worship." But it says of Mary, the mother of Jesus, she said, "My soul doth magnify the Lord." So there is a place. David said it over and over. You know, "My soul exalts the Lord." You know, I mean, somebody grab him and say, "That's soulish worship." As long as it's not only the soul trying to offer to God, but it is the soul in conjunction with the spirit and the spirit and life of Christ offering through the eternal spirit, then your soul is you. Did you know that? Your soul is you. Your mind, your will, and your emotions, and it's lining up with your spirit, which is lined up with the spirit of Christ. Amen? So there is a flow, and there is acceptability in you breaking out into jubilant joy during a worship service. So please feel free to do that. I'm not trying to hinder worship. I'm trying to get us to realize that the Father really does want the Son out of us as earthen vessels, and he can get that in the Father. I mean, you know, the scripture says that the revelation of Christ is the Spirit of God's Son, the Spirit of his Son, coming into your heart crying, "Abba, Father." That's Jesus in you saying, "Father, Father." So sometimes when you're saying, "Father," that may be Jesus in you. Every time it should be. Because he's fathered this new man of which you're a part. Of which you're a part. All right. I'm going to stop, and maybe we can come back in about 10 minutes. How about that? Take a break.